Hi everyone, welcome to my Saturday night session, live session. Hang on, just give me a minute. I'm Dr. Rakhee, pediatrician from... Let me just try and get Captain Srishti. Okay, hi Srishti, okay.
Hi. Hi, how are you?
Always got a technical glitch, so I'm just going to say that all once again. And welcome everybody to our Saturday night live session. I'm Dr. Rakhee, pediatrician from Ayer Damansara Medical Center and Baby and Beyond Publica. And today's live session is COVID-19 and its effect on the aviation industry. And my special guest, very special guest today is Captain Srishti Chandran. Thank you so much, Captain, for joining us today. It's so weird calling you Captain. I've known you for so long already. Time has flown. Do you want to introduce yourself to everybody out there?
Yeah, sure. It's actually quite weird sharing that nowadays because we seldom hear ourselves being called that nowadays either. but yeah, hi everyone. So I am a captain with a local airline over here in Malaysia. Srishti Chandran is my name. Not flying much these days. But anyway, that's my primary job.
Where did you graduate from?
I graduated from the Malaysian Flying Academy in Malacca. Okay. At the time, in 2004, that was where most of the pilots in Malaysia did their training. That was at the time the only flying school around, actually. After that, the aviation industry boomed, and yeah, there was much more.
Yeah, a few more schools came up after that. I remember this one point, there was the only school that was around. Yeah,
exactly.
And how long have you been flying?
Well, I've been flying for quite a while now, more than 15 years with airline. I was 2 years in flying school and 15 years with airline now. So it's been good time, good 15 years.
Yeah, it does. 15 years. And now you're a father, and you know, it's amazing your journey. Absolutely wonderful. Yeah. So how has the pandemic affected the aviation industry? I'll get straight right into the toughest question.
Okay, firstly, whatever I'm going to say is my own opinion. I'm not representing any airline out there, right?
Yeah.
It's just my personal opinion. Yes, definitely. So I think it's really crippled the industry, to say the very least, worldwide, not just in Malaysia. It's brought the whole industry to a grinding halt. It's grounded thousands and thousands of planes worldwide, right? Grounded pilots, cabin crew, all the supporting services. So it's a lot of people who have taken a hit. But it's not just affecting Malaysia, it's worldwide. Hopefully we're going to see things improving next year. But for now, what we have is we have fleets of aircrafts parked in the desert, right? Where we may not even see some of these aircrafts coming back into service. In Malaysia alone, you have got between the different airlines, you have got more than 100 aeroplanes parked on the ground, which have all been wrapped up, literally to keep them in as good condition as you can, right? The aircraft have been wrapped up, they're in hibernation, just waiting for things to improve.
Okay. So my hospital is right next to the Subang Airport, and I do see certain aircrafts, and I was wondering why are they like almost, you know, bubble wrapped in such a way that I was wondering why it wasn't that. So it's just to maintain the integrity of the aircraft, is it?
Yeah, there are a lot of sensitive parts around the aircraft, a lot of probes that need to be covered. Even you'll see things at the wheels, you'll see the tails of the aircraft wrapped up. So there are a lot of parts of the aircraft that need to actually be protected. A lot of exhaust pipes for the auxiliary power units, many things. So the engineers, they have their whole full schedule. Depending on how long the aircrafts are going to be on ground, they would hibernate the aircrafts in different manners.
Okay, awesome. So at some point, I think you need to hibernate. I mean, the pilots and the crew are also in hibernation at the moment. So hopefully once everything opens up, it's going to boom again. So what has happened to all these pilots and, you know, ground crew, flight crew, deck crew, you know, what has happened to the whole team?
Yeah, so I think all the airlines around to survive have all taken different measures to survive. Of course, worldwide, some airlines have more governmental assistance or organizational assistances than other airlines. But basically, right now, everyone, not just, I mean, the pilots, if you go all the way up to the industrial level, all the airlines are struggling to survive as well, right? So, of course, they have taken different initiatives and different measures. The initiatives and measures that they have taken, unfortunately and very sadly, have involved, in some cases, letting go of a couple of... letting go of many pilots, cabin crew, again, all the supporting services. So people have been laid off in right-sizing exercises, after which a big majority of people have also been furloughed. They've been put on a long-term leave without pay, right?
Okay.
The airlines needed to do this. End of day, we need airline to survive to bring everyone back, right? If there's no airline at the end of the day, none of us are going to have our jobs at the other end of this pandemic. So very sadly, we have lots of friends, again, in Malaysia, and I'm talking outside Malaysia, everywhere worldwide, right? It's not limited to Malaysia, who are on long-term leave without pay, running into a year or more, and they're on zero pay. So these are among the initiatives that airlines have done. Of course, the bosses have reassured everyone that they are very, very committed, again, in all airlines, very committed to bringing back everyone as soon as they can. And all of us are definitely banking on the fact that we will come back, we will take to the skies again. Yeah, it's just going to be a while.
Right. Okay, so basically some have been laid off, some have been put on no-pay leave, and some are still the like skeleton crew still running whatever that they need to run at this point, right?
Yes, yes. So for the minimum aircraft that they're keeping, yes, they do have the minimum required crew. Also, of course, we'll be on reduced salaries. We're not flying much, so their allowances will be very much hit as well.
Absolutely.
But all of them are keeping a couple of active.
So how are you surviving? Like, I mean, before this, everybody had their regular pays coming in. You know, you had your flights and everything. Yeah. And then now suddenly it's like, okay, so for those who've put on no-pay leave, how are the pilots and crew? I mean, I know a couple of friends of mine who have started a restaurant business. I know a few who have started being Grab drivers. You know, what have you gone into?
Okay, well, it's been tough for a lot of people because a lot of pilots, not everyone, at least half the pilots went into flying straight away after their high school, right? Or their tertiary education. So we don't have very much else to actually fall back onto. So we have guys who have done phenomenally well in other things. They've remade themselves, right? We have guys who have done different food businesses that are doing very well, coffee businesses, you name it, right? Guys who have pivoted themselves very well. I went into insurance, so now I took up an agency with Great Eastern because I was looking for something else that I'm passionate about. In my case, it has been insurance. It was one more of the topics or conversations I always engaged in, right? Especially at the bars. If it's not buying, then I'm talking about insurance. So I was looking for something else that I'm passionate about. But again, as I say, talking about everyone, all our friends in general, it's not been easy because, as I say, this is something that we have done. It's such a niche market. It's something that we are really good at, right? Flying and our job. So to just pivot yourself to something else, you need to have the passion for it to do it right.
Correct.
So there are guys who are still trying to find different ways out there. But I think for most of the guys we have spoken to, everyone is trying. I mean, whether end of the day, whether it works, something else works for us or not is immaterial as long as we do try something, right? At a time like this.
Absolutely.
It's to try,
I mean, it's tough for everybody out there. And I even saw there was an advertisement a few days back about a pilot who went into fishing business, you know, and now he has a fish farm. You know, so it's amazing how resilient you guys are. And I know that, I mean, a lot of pilot friends of mine like yourself started off, like you said, you know, straight away from high school. It's because you guys were passionate about flying. And that was like the one true love, you know, besides your husbands and wife. But like, it's like, you know, your one true love. And then suddenly you're grounded. So it's like you've sort of lost your purpose in life at some point. And a lot of people are finding it difficult to, you know, to adapt to a sort of new norm without flying. Yeah. So I agree with you. It's difficult, but you've got to do it.
I mean, that's what makes it harder for a lot of guys as well, because it's not just that the pilots are grounded or that they have lost their source of income. Of course, losing the source of income is a big hit on everyone, changes your lives and your family's lives dramatically. But with people in the aviation industry, be it pilot or cabin crew for that matter, these are a bunch of people who really are in the industry just because of their passion for flying, right? Pilots and cabin crew, everyone loved flying from the time they were kids. So you take that away from them. I mean, it's what we do when we go to a bar. We think about in a bar we're talking about flying, right? Our other friends don't want to come to us because we're not doing our job. We're talking about it in the bar, right?
Yeah, exactly. If you're not flying, you're talking about flying. And if you're not talking about flying, you're back to flying. So it's either one of those. So we have Rishi who says, well done on finding something you're passionate about and making it work. Thank you so much, Rishi, for that. So our next question is, what are the SOPs in place to maintain the safety of passengers and crews? Like, you know, the ones that are all, I know a few people who are still flying, and I know some of my friends who are still taking flights inter-country or inter-district or whatever. How do they maintain the SOPs, and what do they do to safeguard the safety of these passengers and crew?
Okay, so there are many different SOPs that different airlines practice, right? So I'm just going to generalize here because they're all pretty similar, right? Okay. Basically, you have different procedures governing the pilots, cabin crew, and all the supporting services to make sure that we don't contaminate anybody else if we were to be infected by the virus. Right. So when we talk first about the operating crew of the aircraft, everybody, of course, number one, we have to be responsible, right? We have to declare if we feel unwell or anything of the sort.
Absolutely.
And there are fixed means of doing it. So example, the day before, the companies will monitor and you need to make a declaration whether or not you're fit, whether you have any symptoms, if you have attended gatherings, so on and so forth. On the day of the flight as well, we go through multiple temperature checks, right? Another declaration of our health. And this is all. The crew, anybody else who's going to be entering the aircraft, so on and so forth. Once you were to get into the cockpit access is restricted as well. So we don't have all the different guys coming in and out of the cockpits as we used to, right? Now, every document that needs to pass is passed through one representative person who is wearing... Yeah, who's wearing full protective gear, and only that one person would come in and give you the documents. Even as far as the crew and their procedures are concerned, they have different destinations of flight risk, right? Depending on the destination you're going to and how risky it is. Certain flights require them to don their full suits. Certain flights may only require them to wear face masks, gloves, etc.
Okay.
Right. So these are among the procedures that the operating crew would take.
Before every flight?
I'm sorry?
Swabs. What about, you know, the testing swabs?
Yeah. So we don't swab before every single flight. We don't. Okay. That being said, I have done multiple swabs due to the job, right? Because every other flight that you do, if a passenger were to be positive, although you may not be in close contact with them, although KKM may not require it, but the airline still goes and takes, most airlines do actually take that extra measure to ground all the crew for a certain amount of time and do swabs just to be, you know, extra safe. But it's not a requirement before every flight. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. All right. So what about the rest of the people? I mean, the passengers, how do we safeguard them?
For the passengers, the aircraft is actually sanitized before every departure and after every arrival. This, depending on the airlines, again, is done in different means. Some airlines have got these UV sanitizers that they push through the aisle, right? And it actually kills any viruses or bacteria on the seats. So you see some airlines having that, especially in Europe and all. Some other airlines use more conventional sanitizing methods, all of which the governing bodies have agreed on that it is equally as effective. But this is done religiously, right? We want to make sure everyone is safe on board. Over and above that, of course, we have the normal SOPs that everybody needs to be masked up the whole time, right? Practice good social distancing. Of course, when you talk about social distancing, when you're on board any public transport for that matter, it's not that easy, right?
Not that easy, yes.
It's not that easy, but aircrafts do have the additional advantage of having very good air circulation systems.
I was just about to ask you that. Yeah, so how does that go?
Okay, so a lot of aircrafts have they have similar circulation systems with minor differences. For example, the air is circulated via through the aircraft, right, by your blower fans. And a certain amount of the air may even be discharged overboard or is discharged overboard. But any or all air that is circulated through the aircraft is circulated via high-efficiency particle arrestors, which we know as HEPA filters, right?
Okay.
These HEPA filters are capable of filtering anything up to the micron requirements of the coronavirus or COVID-19. So all of the air, yeah, is actually circulated via these filters, and actually circulates every 3 minutes, which is a very high circulation rate.
Wow, so that is really high, yeah.
Yeah, so every 3 minutes in that tube of an aircraft, all the air actually is running through these filters. So unlike sitting in an air-conditioned room with a mate who may sneeze there, and now the virus is lingering in the air for hours, you know better than me, right? How long it lingers in the air. But in the aircraft where you have this running through the filters every 3 minutes, it should work great. In theory,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it works wonderful, you know. I mean, because now we're looking at ventilation as one of the main things to reduce aerosolization of the virus. And when you're telling me every 3 minutes the air is changed, I mean, that's, wow, amazing, you know, because now I feel better if someone coughs, like, you know, in first class and I'm like, oh my God, somebody coughed. Yeah, I don't know about you, but I'm one of those people that if I enter a lift and someone coughs, I'm like, immediately, I stop breathing, you know, until like my... Or if somebody sneezes, that's it. I'm not going to take a deep breath until the door opens and I'm out. And so I'm one of those people. So listening to this, like every 3 minutes, it gives me some reassurance that when we do actually go back onto flying, I'll feel much more better and safer. Of course, I won't remove the usual public health measures, but I feel much more safer in that sense. Yeah. So what are the precautions that we should take as passengers? Like if we're going to board a flight, you know, now I know that, okay, the pilots and the crew have got their thing going. You've got a very clean aircraft, but what about the people who are passengers who are boarding? What should we take precautions?
Okay, well, the procedures are there in place to take care of the passengers as it is, right? So I think all we really need everyone to do as passengers will be to responsibly comply with all the procedures that are in place, right? As long as everyone responsibly complies, right? Example, if you're meant to be wearing your face mask, right? I mean, obviously covering your whole face, not just your chin or your mouth, for example. Then that's what we need. We need people to comply, you know? There's no rush, especially now when we practice, even when we board the aircraft, right? In the aero bridge, for example, there may not be as good ventilation as there is on board the aircraft, for example, right? So then, of course, where if there are different procedures in place to stagger the boarding, we need everyone just to comply, right? All the airline businesses, of course, understand that we may not get things done as efficiently as we did before, but it's always safety first. So if it takes us an extra 5 minutes to get a boarding or a disembarkation process done, we do take that hit in order to ensure that we comply with the procedure still. For passengers, of course, it can be discomforting, right? Some people do get claustrophobic when you're up there, right? In a small tube, as you go through a bit of turbulence, people will get worried. Some people do actually get worried during turbulence. Having a mask on may not be the most comfortable thing, right? But we have to remember, it is about protecting everyone else around us, protecting our families. It's our social responsibility just to adhere to the procedures.
So what about if you're taking a flight that's longer than 1 hour or so, you usually get served meals on board. Then what happens? Everybody takes off their masks and eat.
Well, depending, even when it comes to serving meals, depending on the airline procedure, depending on how risky the flights are, on certain high-risk flights, they do not serve hot meals anymore, for example. They may only serve refreshments, right? So it really depends on individual airline procedure and on the specific risk category of the flight. Right? If the flight is clean, maybe not. So this is subject to airline rules. They do this is beyond my pay grade how this decision making is made. But there is a process that they go through and decide how things are to be done. For me personally, if I were to be flying as a passenger, my opinion, if I was sitting beside some unknown person who is not my family member, right, who I've not been living with in the same house, if they were to take off their mask to eat, I would not be eating at the same time as them. I'll keep my mask on at a time. And we actually practice it in the cockpit as well. If we are flying, let's say I'm doing a 4 hour flight cargo, we do get some 4 hour flights, let's say 5 hour flights, whatever it might be. And if I were to be doing that and the other pilot with me needs to have a drink or a meal, whatever it might be, right? While they are consuming their meal or having their drink, I'm going to keep my mask on, right?
Okay.
When they are done, right, they mask back up. At least we reduce the risk then, right?
Yeah. I mean, that's a good tip as well, you know. Like, I don't even know their vaccination status, you know. So if everybody is vaccinated, I'll feel a bit better. But I don't know who you are and what's your exposure like and all. So, That's a good tip. Thank you so much for that. But what about seating arrangements?
No? Sorry, talking about vaccination. Talking about the vaccination, just to add on that, procedure-wise, I think as well most airlines are still following this. The procedures are still the same across the board, regardless if they are vaccinated or not. Because we, at this stage, when the vaccination rates are low and before governmental regulations change, before there's a review of all health procedures, for now, because we do, you are inevitably going to get people who come fully vaccinated thinking that I'm safe, right? You may have everyone beside you vaccinated, all we have discussed, you're vaccinated, I'm vaccinated, so why are we doing this? But end of the day, even if you're vaccinated, you still can actually transmit the virus to other people, right? And of course, there are those breakaway cases where you still can get infected as well, right? So until there's an overall change in procedures, I think we should still, regardless whether vaccinated or not, still comply with the regulations.
And especially because I'm pretty sure there are some amount of children that are also flying with their parents, and children can't be vaccinated, especially the ones below 12. So, I mean, to safeguard the children, I think it's best if you just keep your mask on throughout your flights and all. So, how do you foresee, what do you foresee is the future of the airline industry? What's going to happen? Please tell me I can fly next year, please.
Okay, well, again, this is one more thing that's definitely well above my pay grade to answer. But
as a pilot,
I can only say I hope that as soon as possible. My first hope, to be very frank, will be that everybody who is on leave without pay and or everyone who was let go in the right sizing exercises to no fault of their own, the first hope that everyone is praying for is for every one of our friends, every one of our colleagues to be brought back into the system, right? And from listening to all our bosses speaking, what we understand, again, industry-wide, right? We're all different airlines. All the bosses are committed, from our understanding, to that being their first goal, to bring everyone back, right? Because all the bosses have said how it's the staff, right, who help make the different airlines. So they do want to save them. Just that for now, unfortunately, the airlines had to survive. So they needed to do what they did. So... in the future, of course, that is the imminent goal or the imminent thing that we're looking forward to. Once that happens, we are definitely hoping for pre-COVID levels. We can hope. America has started off well. It was very enlightening last week to hear that they were canceling flights because of pilot shortages. In America, they actually canceled. You have guys on leave without pay. It does take a few weeks to bring back the guys who are on leave without pay. Because naturally, when you have not been flying for a while, right, you need to go through refresher trainings, right? There are a couple of checks, ground classes. Everyone needs to get back to where they were, right, in terms of proficiency for safety reasons. So that may take, will take some time, again, depending on the length that anyone has been absent. So, again, that's why in America, all of a sudden, when you see, okay, a new place has opened, we're launching another 10 flights, but, hey, they were short of pilots. So for us to see that happening in America, was really, really good.
Everyone's very encouraging. Watching.
Yeah, it's very encouraging. So we're hoping that will happen. Of course, the worry is things are a pandemic, lead recession, right? That's the worry that's on all our minds. The other worry, of course, is with a lot of businesses pivoting the way they do business, right? A lot of people have realized that they can successfully have meetings online via Zoom and all these things, right? Yeah. So there may be a slight hit there, I would imagine, in my own opinion. There may be a slight hit there. From the business travelers. But I'm confident, definitely confident things will pick up. It has to.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it's not about the business travelers anymore. You've got a whole bunch of Malaysians. Out of the 32 million, I'm pretty sure 30 million are dying to just take a flight and even just go to Thailand or Singapore. Go to anywhere that's even an hour away. I think everybody's just, just cooped up in the house. I think there's a little bit of pandemic fatigue going on. So I have no worries. Even if the business guys don't support you, you have us, the tourists that will definitely support the airline industry. Yeah. So do you have any last words that you want to say before we take this off?
No, I think this is an interesting experience that we're all going through. It's the war of our time, right? Much as in this case, we're talking about aviation, there are people in all other industries struggling, right? So I think we're all in this together. We all just have to get through it, right? When the going gets tough, the tough gets going, right? So we must find a way to get through it. And it will be something that, as everyone's saying, they will be talking about in 20 years' time, right? as a good experience. But it's a good. We should take this time, I think, all of us, regardless of our industry, to try something new, right? Whatever it might be, right? Whether it's gardening, whether it's anything, but to try something new that we would not have had the time to do if not.
And if you haven't thought about insurance, I think this is the time to think about insurance. So look at Captain Srishti if you want to get a hold of him and get into insurance. The going just got tougher with his government. Our government's making all sorts of decisions. So anyway, thank you so much, Captain Srishti, and good luck. And may the force be with you. And hope to see you one time physically soon. Take care. Thank you so much for doing this.
See you soon.
All right. Bye-bye.